Hello and a very warm welcome to a brand new edition of To The Point with me, Frank Pereira, on Rajya Sabha Television. Bihar is heating up. The gloves are well and truly off, and it's heading towards a no-holds-barred contest between the so-called Secular Alliance and the NDA. The Mahagathbandhan is now just the Gathbandhan, but it still packs a punch. And the BJP, even though it has come out in the media and said that all is well within the NDA, there are a few disgruntled voices emerging within the NDA. And to talk about all of this, Bihar and much more, I have with me the National General Secretary of the BJP, Mr. Muralidhar Rao. Mr. Rao, thank you so much for joining me on the program. You know, to the media, all is well within the NDA. You've seen the BJP president and all the other constituents of the NDA alliance come out and smile to the media, distribute sweets and say that all is well. But then we've seen that the LJP seems to be a little disgruntled with the seat sharing as far as Bihar is concerned. Is that a problem?
No, I don't see it as a problem. But definitely I understand every party in the alliance, they will have some kind of challenges in handling their cadres and about their expectations, particularly in this kind of situation. NDA is in power in Delhi, it's at the center, it is governing. And in the last parliament elections, we have done very well, overwhelmingly well in Bihar. Now we think, every one of us, we think that we are going to a kind of pilot the change process which is happening in Bihar. In such a situation, definitely each of the constituents will have a kind of expectations from its cadres and following. It is a natural thing. But we have learnt and we have to, learn to handle all these things, ups and downs and these expectations. I feel this is not going to create any big challenge. The leadership of NDA means BJP and the leaders of the constituent parties, they will understand and they are mature enough to understand. Here the biggest challenge is how to herald the change. That is the important thing and that is the paramount thing for which everybody has to adjust and is ready to adjust.
This particular election, Bihar, has been made an election between the Chief Minister and the Prime Minister of the country. Should the Prime Minister be so involved in a state election?
No, it is not in that way one should perceive or one should analyze. Here, Chief Minister has tried to convert this issue, this election into election between Chief Minister and Narendra Modi ji. It is not like that. Definitely, Modi ji has brought a kind of a culture change in the governance. Now, for the first time in this country, good governance has become the electoral issue. And the development is discussed. Normally, in all elections, non-political factors, whether it is social factor or it is other factors, they used to dominate, and particularly Bihar used to be the a kind of place where non-political issues used to dominate. Now, really political issues are now, and the governance issue is becoming a issue of debate in Bihar. This is a welcoming thing which is happening.
Was that why the special package was announced?
No, special package was always
with an eye on the Bihar polls.
No, in this, one should not take that it's only election centric. It was long pending and it was due. And
but the timing has been questioned. The timing could have been something else.
Always a political party, when you do something, if you do something, you will add color to it. If you do not do that kind of thing, then you will raise the question. So even the last 1 year we have done, then also these questions would have been like this. So in this election in Bihar, now the point is governance versus a kind of chaotic and misgovernance or bad governance or jungle raj in a popular way. So that is going to be the issue. And Modi ji represents and he has become a kind of iconic symbol for the good governance. This we have to accept all over the country.
So would you then concede at least that this is a make or break election for the duo of the Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Amit Shah, because they're putting everything into it?
Definitely, in every election, BJP puts everything into it. When we go for election to win the war, to win the election. So this is a natural thing for a political party and a political leadership. So our national president, Shri Amit Shah, is doing all kinds of preparations to take the party's message and message of the Prime Minister to the people of Bihar. But and we are going to win, definitely. We have complete confidence, and we have that kind of belief that people of Bihar this time are going to give the mandate for the change. But this is not an issue where Prime Minister is evaluated. Prime Minister is evaluated all over the country. And the performance of this government is evaluated all over the country, not necessarily in the state context.
Indeed. You know, this particular election in Bihar, you've not gone with a chief ministerial face. Is that something that you've learned from the Delhi election?
No, it is not that. Even before, we have not declared a chief ministerial candidate in Haryana election.
Yes.
We have not
and
declared.
And it worked well for you.
Yeah, this is an issue purely related to the electoral strategy. It is a tactical issue. You know, how you are placed, how you are going to face the elections, and how it is going to be beneficial for it. Based on the feedback from the party, from the bottom, we will be having. And technically speaking, this elected representatives are going to sit, and they are going to elect the leader afterwards. Even otherwise also, even if we declare the leader, then also the legislators have to sit and decide. So that is not a big issue, and that should not be seen as
Were you
something.
Concerned that there are too many people in the fray to become the chief minister of Bihar, and if you go with the chief ministerial face, then there will automatically be infighting within the party, and that could cause more trouble?
You know, we are not declaring a chief ministerial candidate does not mean there is a conflict within the party, and our inability to declare a candidate before elections has made us to go like this. It should not be the view. Sometimes party, when it goes to elections, then we take the feedback and we take the everything into consideration. Then based on that, we decide what is the best strategy. So that only has made this party leadership to take this decision.
Okay. You know, you said that you're going to win, and you're going to win comfortably in Bihar. According to your internal estimates, how many seats do you, intend to win in Bihar?
You know, this elections definitely we will have not just a kind of manageable majority. We will be having the comfortable majority, which is required to translate the aspirations for change.
Would you stick your neck out and then say a two-thirds majority?
You know, when I say comfortable majority, it must be sufficient, and one should not be surprised even if we get two-thirds majority, because we have just now election process has started. As we go nearer to elections, and these are five-phase elections, definitely we will have a good majority, overwhelming support from the people in Bihar. Change is going to be the factor, a reality.
Does the Grand Alliance, no more Grand Alliance, but still a formidable alliance, worry the BJP and its allies in some way?
No, it is not, a challenge at all. People in Bihar, they have decided change is need and change is imminent. And this Grand Alliance is completely based on a negative agenda. They don't have any positive agenda to have this kind of alliance. They are against somebody, and they want to fight a survival battle so as to survive. They have put together all these things. They don't have a common approach. They don't have even common identity. They don't have any common ideological basis to have this. The people who were always fighting for, a kind of against Congress politics, now they joined Congress. And the people who fought against Srimati Sonia Gandhi, now they joined Srimati Sonia Gandhi. And even Rahul Gandhi now, who was not interested in sharing the dais with the Lalu Yadav. Now he is ready to act, you know, adjust.
So it's politics of opportunism is what you're saying.
Completely politics of opportunism, and it is only the survival interest making them to adjust in like this.
Okay. You know, earlier in the program, I said this could be a make or break election for the BJP, not because of anything else. It's because of the states that are going to polls next year in 2016. There are three states at least where the BJP has negligible presence, which is Kerala, which is Tamil Nadu, and which is West Bengal. So what are your, you know, your views on these three states? How is the BJP looking at some of these southern states as well as West Bengal?
Here, one tectonic shift is going to take place in this country's politics. Congress used to be a very important party and a kind of a major force in the entire rainbow spectrum of Indian political formations. In these states, Congress slowly became weak and it has also disappeared from the scene. If you take in Tamil Nadu, Congress is not a force. In Bengal, it also has become a negligible force. Now, in this situation, people are looking for the strong national and nationalist political party.
So, is it the end of the regional parties then? Are you predicting the end of the regional
parties? No, I don't say that, you know, it is the end of the thing. There is enough space for regional parties even when BJP becomes powerful. Even when BJP becomes a ruling party in the southern states, then also there is a scope and space for the regional parties. So I don't say that regional parties are now going to get obliterated. I don't say that. But definitely, as a national political party, we have identified these states as very important states where BJP should grow and BJP should consolidate on the strength which has already been built in the last parliament elections. And definitely you will see BJP emerging as a decisive player in all these states.
Okay. On that note, we'll slip into a short break now, but we'll continue talking to Mr. Rao about various other things, mainly, of course, the reforms agenda of the government. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television in conversation with the National General Secretary of the BJP, Mr. Muralidhar Rao. Mr. Rao, let's talk about the reforms agenda of the government. Now, it seems like the government has been dealt a few blows of late. Of course, we saw with the land ordinance, you went all out to try and push for the land ordinance for about a year or a little more than a year, but then ultimately had to let go of it. You did not even re-promulgate the ordinance. How much of an impact is it really going to have on some of the reforms agenda of the government?
No, I don't link the whole reform agenda with the land ordinance issue. On land ordinance issue, definitely the leadership in the government has taken a kind of democratic approach where different farmer organizations and people representatives and non-governmental organizations, they have taken a view on that, and all those things are considered by the government and the state governments also, because ultimately the land issue has to be handled by the state governments, so they have to handle the issue. So in such a situation, state governments also should have a space in that when we formulating the whole thing. So this has been taken into consideration. Based on that, the ordinance is allowed to get lapsed. But on the other reforms issues, if you take GST, if you take all other issues and the different bills, Congress behavior and its leadership attitude has completely come in a negative way. They have not been able to digest the victory of BJP or Narendra Modi ji, and they are not able to adjust with the reality that this leadership becoming successful and this government becoming a performing government. So in order to put a spanner in the whole process, they have even worked on a negative agenda.
Was it also a case of an overconfident government not anticipating some of these moves by the opposition?
you know, we have never thought Congress can become a force of obstruction. And it is ready to, you know, sabotage the democratic debate. This we never expected. And definitely we also have some problems. We do not have the adequate numbers in Rajya Sabha. That is the reality. And in 40 versus 400, now it has become, you know, a popular issue. So Congress as a party and its leadership has, you know, tried to put obstacles in this kind of debate, even on the issues where it had accepted earlier. So, but in ultimately we are going to the people, and in coming days the situation will change. And even the other opposition parties are also realizing this will cost them very badly. So things may change in future, I feel. And Prime Minister is boldly dealing with the situation and is handling. And the performance of the government should not get affected in the process is the attitude of the government.
Indeed. Now, you know, we'll talk about the GST and some of the labor reforms as well in just a bit. But before that, what happens to the BJP's land bill now? Is it something that you're going to revisit maybe once you have the numbers in the Rajya Sabha as well?
No, it is not just a question of the numbers of Rajya Sabha. Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister has always said that we are ready to listen to everybody, and if there is any constructive suggestion to improve upon the bill, we are always ready. So, and the state governments and the chief ministers of respective states, they also have to come up. And there is a joint action panel now, which is looking into the issue, and the, based on the report of that also, ultimately we will go with the consensus.
So you're waiting for consensus, you're going to take everyone along is what you're saying. Let's talk about the Constitution Amendment Bill, because you said it's not just a land ordinance, there are other aspects to it as well. Constitutional Amendment Bill, making the GST a reality in April 2016 is also a major problem as far as the reforms agenda is concerned. So how are you going to tackle this issue of GST? First and foremost, are you going to meet the deadline of April 1st, 2016?
You know, ultimately, people, they know what is the required action in order to implement GST. Parliament has to amend. In this, then ultimately the opposition parties and the respective state governments and all those things have to be considered. It is related to a process, and the process involves a dialogue. And Honorable Finance Minister is taking all these initiatives, and hope the opposition parties will also understand the necessity of bringing the constitutional amendment. So we are going to make earnest efforts to make this a reality.
You know, there was talk of having a special session, and that's why the houses weren't prorogued, so that, you know, a session could be called immediately so that at least the GST bill could be passed. That has not happened. Now we'll have to wait for the winter session for any movement as far as GST is concerned. After all these obstacles, and then once it is passed, it has to be ratified by over 50% of the states. So looking at all of these obstacles and looking at all of these challenges, do you still believe that the deadline can be met?
You know, it is for me difficult to say about the, you know, deadlines for this kind of thing, because the people who in the business only can explain about the timelines.
But is that something you're worried about?
But the worry is how Congress party wants to see the parliament functioning. Ultimately, they have also a responsibility as a responsible opposition.
But the Congress has said that, you know, you did the same thing to us when we were in power, when we were the government of the country, and the same thing is happening to you when you're in power.
You know, it is not a, you know, settlement of the accounts. And the situation was different. Equating the both the situations are not going to be, you know, it is not, you know, justified. And ultimately, political positioning is also there. Maybe people are, different leaders are expecting something from Bihar and they are not in a position to change their stance, maybe. But in coming days, situation will alter and people will realize.
You know, there's a problem with the labor reforms as well. I mean, the government is desperately trying to get some labor reforms in place. But, you know, labor unions are not allowing that to happen because that too is a problem, isn't it?
You know, the it is not a consolidated opposition on every issue. On the labor front, there are different voices. And all are not united and all are not having the identical approach on all the issues. Government is having a dialogue with the leadership of the trade unions and the labor unions. Definitely on the labor reforms front, government will be able to have some breakthroughs and by building a kind of confidence or trust which is required. And ultimately government is not, this government particularly under Modi ji's leadership is not against labor and it cannot be seen as anti-labor. So this will not happen. There will be forward movements from the government on the issues by taking them on board.
You know, these issues were something that the RSS also took keen interest in. The RSS also took up as far as some of these issues are concerned. We had the Samanmay Baithak, which was a Baithak where several of the senior leaders from within the BJP also went and met, you know, fellow RSS cadres and fellow RSS leaders as well and spoke about some of these issues. So what is the RSS's take on some of these issues and delivering on some of these promises are concerned?
You know, RSS as an organization will not have a definite opinion on the issues which are purely political or purely economical. They may have some broad direction on the economy or economic direction or a philosophy, ideologically. And they may have some broad direction on the political issues. But when it comes to the micromanagement of the things, RSS will not be having a definite view. And RSS Samanvay meeting, it is not between the government and RSS Parivar. It is only a kind of routine organizational coordination meeting which takes place and where BJP as one of the Parivar organizations, it has taken part in that meeting and it happens in a routine way. Since BJP is in government, now it is viewed as RSS and government coordination. It should not be viewed in that way. And the organizations within the RSS Parivar, they have a positive opinion about the government and they also have the positive expectations from the government. And the inputs which they give in different sectors, definitely all those inputs are taken in a positive way. But it does not mean that government will be accepting every input and it will be able to implement every suggestion which is given by these respective organizations.
Will we see more such meetings in the future?
It is a routine process. We don't have any inhibition in accepting that BJP is part of a broad school of thought of RSS, and ultimately you see BJP is formed on the basis of this dual membership problem. We have not accepted to dissociate ourselves from the RSS. So that was the issue. So in such a situation, these kind of meetings should be seen as a routine occurrences.
You know, you said that the RSS does not involve itself in the micro level functioning of the government and everything else that the government does. But there are some others who do not agree with it. For instance, it has always been said that the government is remote controlled by the RSS. Sitaram Yechuri of the CPI has gone a step further and said that the government is controlled by the RSS.
The problem with Sitaram Yechuri is he is always, misreads. And that is the problem. As a leader of the party, he has not been able to arrest its decline. He is not able to read the people's mood also. So we have to understand, once you say Narendra Modi ji is an authoritarian leader And Narendra Modi ji is even to the extent of that, you know, there is no democratic principles for him to that extent. And when you propagate for so many years on that line, now you come and say that RSS is controlling Narendra Modi ji. These are not going to get accepted by the people. You know, nobody in the world and in this country are going to accept that our Honorable Prime Minister is a weak man and he is going to get dictates from any organization. And RSS is not an organization which takes interest in deciding about the persons, deciding about the policies of, you know, in all these things. The micromanagement is not the job of RSS, and it has never taken interest in those things. It is interested in, you know, broad principles.
All right. On that note, we'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of To The Point because we're completely out of time. Thank you so much, Mr. Muralidhar Rao, for being with us on the program. A pleasure having you on the show. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much for watching. See you again next time.